Welcome to Quick Instances Pro. This is a Blender add-on that will allow you to organize large scenes or complex models where grouping of objects becomes a necessity. Blender has three ways of creating groups, and I'll take you through them. Here's the first, which is called parenting. So we'll select the default cube, we'll remove the light, the camera, we don't need those, and duplicate the cube a couple of times. Alright. We now have a small group of cubes, and they're in a collection called Collection, and the collection is in Blender's master scene collection, default collection. You can't change its name or you can't even remove it, so everything, all collections will belong inside that collection within a scene. So to create a parenting scenario, what we do is we'll select a couple of the cubes to be parented, and then we'll lastly select the parent cube, and we'll go Control P and set parent object keep transform. So we kept the transform just in case we've moved the cubes before we parented them. That's what that does. Now you'll notice that since we do that, some relationship lines are shown from the parent cube to the child cubes. That's to show the child-parent relationship. And if you select the parent and move the parent, the child cubes follow. And if you scale or rotate the parent cube, again the child cubes follow. But if you select the child cubes individually, they still retain their independence. So this is not quite what we want in terms of a self-contained group, the definition of which is that if you can select any object in the group, the whole group follows, just like when you select the parent. So let's undo this. This doesn't quite take us where we want to go. And you select the two cubes to be unparented and just Alt P. And that's just clear and keep transformation. All right. Blender's second method is joining. It's not a bad method, but it has one or two small limitations. Okay, so to join, you select them all, and so note first of all that in the collection we have the three cubes, cube, cube 1, cube 2, and they're in the collection called collection. So as soon as I join them, which is Control J, note that the very last cube I selected, all the cubes are merged into that last cube. All the three cubes are now are one cube, and there's no such thing as the other two cubes anymore. They're gone. Their identity has been erased, sort of. So in fact we've created a kind of a self-cohering entity here, which is great. That's really useful. Great. But editing can become a bit of a pain. You've got to go into edit mode and then you've got to find where you want to be in those. You can use L to select loose parts. That's one way of doing it. So, you know, but if the objects are, you know, intertwined and complex, you know, you can have some trouble. So it's not quite maybe as helpful as it seems. But certainly if you want to undo them, this is where things get a bit tricky. So if you want to undo these guys and restore them to their original state, you go into edit mode, you select all, and then you hit P and you separate by loose parts. Now, but look what happens. Since I've done that, right, look what happened to the names of them. They were changed. So cube becomes cube 1, cube 2, cube 3. The naming conventions changed. If you've got a lot of these objects and you've gone through all the trouble of naming them, that's all out the window now. It's gone. So be aware of that. This is one of the limitations. And now naming and organizing is actually a big part of big scenes. If you just throw things in randomly, you want to find something afterwards, it can get really difficult. So it's always best to have good naming and good organization of big scenes. And so this will definitely mess that up. Another thing is if you start duplicating this joined group, you'll start having memory overhead. Of course, the solution is to create an instance out of it, and that's what brings us to the last method, creating collection instances. Because an instance is a very, very low memory copy of the original source objects. That's the way to go. But in Blender's instancing method has some drawbacks, and we're going to show you those now. So let's take these objects and use Blender's collection instancing method. We're in the collection called collection, so if we go to the add menu and we go down, we can see that we have collection instance there. If we select collection there, it makes an instance collection out of the original collection. So when you first look at this, you think, wow, okay, so what's happened? In fact, Blender will put an empty wherever the 3D cursor is located at that moment in time that you make the instance. That's the first thing. And that becomes the pivot point of the instance. So I'll move the instance aside and show you that, in fact, it the original objects, the source objects, are still in the scene. This is one of the first drawbacks, that it can clutter your scene when you make an instance, because it leaves the source objects in your scene, and if you don't want them there, you've got to figure out a way of getting rid of them. Well, one way is you can hide them, but if you've got a huge hierarchy, that can get also nasty. So that's not necessarily a clean way of doing it. If you want to edit, well, of course, if you want to edit your instance, the source object, by editing the source object, you'll edit the instance objects. But Blender doesn't consider the instance, those three cubes here in this instance, as individual objects. It considers this instance as a single object, and it references the empty. If you ask for its origin point, its location, it will give you the location of the empty, not the objects in the instance itself. That's a bit of more tricky way that you need to go through to get those the data for these instance objects. Now, Blender also does something else. It when you create an instance, it drops it into the scene collection. So even though the instance source objects were in the collection called collection, when the instance was made, it took the instance out and dropped it into the scene collection. Not too handy, because if you're deep in your hierarchy somewhere and you've created your instance, it takes it all out and all the way and drops it into the scene collection. You've got to grab it and bring it all the way back and find where it was. That's another kind of a problem with this method. So why quick instances is called quick is because it does all this work for you quickly, and it saves you all the headache of messing around organizing things after and cleaning up after you've made the collection instance with Blender's method. Let's go ahead and do that now. So we'll remove this instance and we'll install quick instances. And now I'm using Blender 4.1 because 4.2, as you probably know, is now is deprecated the add-on method, has now turned them into extensions, and so this add-on is not up to date for that yet. So this add-on only works up to Blender 4.1. Hopefully in the next few weeks I'll figure out how to upgrade the add-on so they can also become compatible with Blender 4.2 onwards. But for now it's compatible up to 4.1, and here's the legacy method now of installing an add-on. You go to Preferences, make sure you're in the add-on section, and you hit Install, find where your add-on is, mine's the desktop, grab it, install it, and check it. Save your preferences and go back to your 3D view. It's now installed. So now we're ready to go through and do a tutorial on how to use quick instances. All right. So this version of Quick Instances Pro has two operating methods. You can either use the Pi menu, and you can access that with Control Shift I for instance. So it's easy to remember. Control Shift I. And you can see when you do that, you get a Pi menu coming up, and it gives you the different functions: create group, add to group, remove from group, ungroup, edit group, and you've got some other functions there which we'll discuss further in the tutorial. And you have help. Help, if you click that, it'll give you the quick keys, the shortcut keys, to do the same operations. So Control G is create group, Control U is undo group, Control Shift A is add to group, Control Shift E is toggle edit group. Now that's interesting, because it's a toggle function. So if you select a group and then you Control Shift E on it, you'll go into edit mode and you'll be able to edit that group. And if you hit Control Shift E again, it'll just drop you back out into the working scene. So that's handy. And then you've got Control Shift W, which takes you into a second level of editing. We'll discuss that as the tutorial goes on. And then finally you've got Control Alt O, which is just to remove objects out of a group. Okay, so that's pretty straightforward. So let's go ahead and create a group. Now remember, when you create a group, wherever the 3D cursor was is where the origin of that group will be located. If you want to be really specific about your origin, if you want to put it in a specific spot, for example, on this vertex right here, you need to obviously snap your 3D cursor to wherever you want the origin point to be before you make your group. So I'm just going to put my group origin here though. So let's go and select the group and go Control G, and just like that we've made a group. Now notice, as soon as we made it, there's no source objects left in the scene, and the group importantly is made in the same collection that you made it, so you retain your hierarchy, and it takes the name of the collection that it belonged to, the common collection, and it gives the name of the group as a suffix. Now, as good as that is, we need to know a bit more, because when you create a group, it's important that all the objects belong to the same named collection. Now, let me explain. So let's create some objects here. Let's do some UV spheres. We'll duplicate a few of those. And we'll create a few, how about a few cones? Let's do those as well. We'll put those up here. Okay, so we've got a few cones, we've got a few spheres. All right, so now they're all currently in a collection called collection, but I'm going to now disperse them through different collections. I'm going to create a new collection here called collection 2, and I'll grab the spheres and I'll drop them into collection 2, and I'll take the cones and I'll drop them into the scene collection. So you can see now that we have some cones in the scene collection, some spheres in collection 2. If we want to make a group out of these guys now, these cones and spheres, let's see what happens. A message comes up and says, selected objects must belong to a single name collection other than the scene collection in order to create a group. Okay, so that means we've got to take these cones out of the scene collection and drop them into at least collection 2, along with the spheres which are in collection 2. And now that all the objects are in the same named collection, we can now turn them into a group. Again, here we go. Bingo. We have another group. So here's our group of cones and spheres because they're in the same name collection. So that's important. You have to have them in the same name, but that rule doesn't apply to adding to a collection, which we're going to do now. So you saw before undoing collections control U, which is pretty straightforward. I don't think we need to really go into detail about that. Just control U, undo it, end of story. But adding to collection is a bit more interesting, because you can have objects anywhere you like in your hierarchy. It doesn't matter. They can be in the scene collection, they can be in other collections, dispersed all over the place. Once you select the final group as the final selection in your series of selections, as the group to which you want to add all those objects, all the objects will automatically migrate from wherever they were into your group and be added. So I'll give you an example, right? So let's make some more objects. How about a few cylinders? Yeah, we'll do that. A couple of cylinders here. Let's add a couple of icospheres. That'll do. We'll put a few icospheres in there. Okay, so we've now got our original group called Collection GRP, and we've got the icospheres, which we're going to drop now into the scene collection, right? And we'll take our cylinders and we'll drop them into collection 2. So they are in collection 2 already, that's fine. So now we've got icospheres in the scene collection, cylinders in collection 2, and the group which we want to add them to is in collection. So I'm now going to grab all those objects and then lastly select the group I want to add them to and go Control Shift A, and automatically they were added to that group, like just like that. So what basically that means is that they migrated across to the collection you wanted them to be added to, and it saved you the work of moving them into the collection before adding them. That's all it did, to save you that extra step. Because after all, when you add them, you want to add them to the group that's under the same collection name. Now, if you undo them, right, if you undo this group now, you'll find that they will be undone in the collection to which you were added. That's important, because that's where you wanted to move them after all in the end anyway, so it's to save you that extra step. But just be aware that when you do undo them, it will undo them in the name collection to which the group you added them to resided in. And importantly, all the names are retained. So all the original names that you had for the objects are all retained. Nothing's lost. That's important, because if you went through all the trouble of naming them, you'd have to name them again. So handy. Now, so we know how to add to a group and undo a group and create a group. We just now have to do taking things out of a group. Okay, well, that's pretty straightforward. So I'll just create a group out of these guys again. So create a group here, and I'll just add these guys again back to the group. So I'll do that again as well. So they're added now. And so now to take out from a group, you need to go into edit mode. So Control-Shift-E drops you into edit mode. I'm now in the first level of editing, and I've gone into the editing of this group, and I can now choose any one of these objects and move them out. So let's move the icospheres out. So to do that, select them and Control-Alt-O. And they just pop out, and we'll go back to Control-Shift-E again, so we'll toggle back to the main scene, and there they are. The icospheres have been dropped out exactly in the location that they were specified. They didn't move to strange positions or anything. They stayed exactly where they were, and were taken out. So here we go, here's our group, and here's the icospheres separated. Nice. So that's how you take out of a group and add to group, create a group and undo a group. Now we get interesting, because now we're going to go to the next level, which is called nested groups. And that is making groups out of groups. So if we have a group here, right? Or in fact, what I'll do first is I'll just edit it and just take those two cylinders out. I think we can just clean up a bit. All right. So now, just keep those cylinders separate for a moment. And here's our cube group. What do we got over here? We've got a sphere and cone group. All right, that'll do. So we have a sphere and cone group, and we have a cube group. And we can technically add those two groups together and make a group out of a group, what's called a nested instance collection or nested group. Right, so make sure that once again they're in the same name collection. They're in different name collections. So if we try to group them now, we get a message. Select objects must belong to the single name. Blah, 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 right? So let's move one of them into the same thing. So let's move the cubes into collection 2. Now that collection, the cubes are in collection 2 and the cones and the spheres are in collection 2. And now when we grab them and we control G on them to create an instance, bang, we can create one. And by doing that, it's created a suffix nest group. That tells you nested is a nested group, and group is a nested. So it tells you that the naming convention tells you straight away, aha, so this is a group of groups. Now, if you want to go and edit it, you can drop in simply the same way, Control-Shift-D, and here we can see straight away that the two groups are independent, once from the first level of editing. But what happens if I want to take those cones out of this group over here of cones and spheres? What I want to get those cones out. Well, to do that, we go to a second level of editing. So we go Control-Shift-W, and now we jump into the cones and spheres, and now we can edit those. We can move them around, do whatever you like, scale, blah, 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 whatever. But in this case, let's take those cones out. So we'll go Control-Alt-O, take them out. We'll go back one level, Control-Shift-W, and you can see now that we've got the spheres by themselves, the cubes by themselves, and the cones as individual objects by themselves. But if we go back to the main scene, Control-Shift-E, so back to the main scene now, we still got the nested collection there. Look, it's still a nested group. We still got the cubes, the spheres, and the cones. We took the cones out. Why are they not out? Well, actually, we only took them out of the sphere group inside the nested group. To take them fully out of the nested group, we have to do one extra level, don't we? You have to go back into the edit mode, grab them again, and one more time, Control-Shift-O, and then now, when we go back to the main scene, they're fully out. Here they are. They're fully out of the nested group. That's how you edit nested groups. So you can even do more. You can go back into a nested group. I can now add, let's say, for example, I had some objects here. I can go put a cylinder here, duplicate it a couple of times, and I can add that to my sphere group while I'm in the first level of editing. So I'm editing a nested group, a group of groups, and I can now select those two cylinders, select my group of spheres, and Control-Shift-A, and I've added the cylinders to the spheres. Just like that. That easy. And if I go back out, Control-Shift-E to the main scene again, I've now got a nested collection of cubes, spheres, and cylinders, and so on and so forth. So you can do almost endless combinations with this add-on. And it's clean. Everything is maintained. It's nice and easy to use. You get used to the shortcut keys pretty quick, but as I said before, if you like to use the Pi method, Control-Shift-I takes you to Pi, and you can just use any of those functions in the same way as you use the shortcut keys, and they'll do the same thing. And if you want to learn, just go back and hit help, and it gives you the names of and the other shortcut keys. So I think that pretty much covers everything. I can't see anything else. Oh, there's probably one more thing worth mentioning, and that is, let's go back into the nested instance collection here, and let's have a look. Here's something interesting. Some people might try to, for example, regroup a group within a nested group, which is like grouping of a grouping of a grouping, which is kind of a bit crazy. I've had to deal with the issue, and I'm preventing users from doing that. So if you try to do that, I'll show you what happens. Look, Control-G. You can't implement grouping while in edit mode. Right. Excellent. So that's prevents you right there from going any further. So you only need to have two levels, really. Just you have your regular groups and you have your nested groups, and with those two combinations you can pretty much do anything you like. You don't need groups of groups of groups of groups of groups of groups, of groups and so on ad infinitum. It's just crazy. So I think I covered all. Hopefully people using it won't find any bugs. I've tested it exhaustively, so I can't find any more bugs, and had other people test it and they couldn't find any, so I think hopefully we won't have any, but I'm pretty sure a bug will turn up eventually. My details are in there, you can contact me and I'll definitely get onto it and try and fix it. But apart from that, happy blending.